Siamo con Paul Cotman. Paul è professore di inglese alla New School di New York, è un specialista di Shakespeare ed è autore di un libro che si chiama The Scene of Politics, tra l'altro. Io gli do la parola, la sua relazione si intitola The Night in Which All Colors Are Black, Gaps, Voids, Ruptures in Political Discourse.
Responding to a contest held in 1749 by the Academy of Dijon, which asked whether the progress of the sciences and the arts contributed to the corruption or the improvement of human conduct, Rousseau's famous answer was corruption rather than improvement. Is that too much? Rousseau's essay represents one of the first attempts to mark out the limits in principle, not limits based on temporary empirical ignorance, of modern scientific understanding in contributing to human self-knowledge. And so what Rousseau insisted on was an unusual sort of necessary independence or privileged importance of what we can call moral or normative matters. In addition to expressing what have since become well-known complaints about modernity, how modern forms of social life might be deeply unsatisfying or downright undesirable, what Rousseau delineated was the importance, or at least the possibility, of responding to historical actions and events with a question, why? Why did this happen? Why did these events occur? Without turning to inherited beliefs or theological revelation or to the deliverances of the modern sciences. So let's think of this as the ambition of the modern humanities, and that's what I want to try to talk about and defend today, in a way that might fill in some of the gaps of indeterminacy that, as a humanist, I see predominant in the discourse around psychoanalysis and politics. So since I'm not a political theorist or a psychoanalyst particularly, but rather a humanist, I want to devote my 30 minutes to talking about what I think the ambitions of the humanities should be with respect to social and political change. What I want to suggest is that we should just simply try to make social and historical transformation intelligible, discernible from the point of view of rational agency, so that we ought to develop some connection between self-consciousness and reason that should save us from the notion that the act of political institution finds its only source in the act itself. So I want to defend a little bit against that. In asking after reasons, when we ask after the reasons for an action, the question why, we're asking after motivations that are intertwined with routine, practical modes of justification that adhere in a given society's self-conception. So this is not to deny that we tend, as individuals, to take subjective or reflective stances on what we do. Doubtless there's an important connection between an individual's relation to her actions and whatever is actually done, collectively or individually. But my point is that figuring out this connection shouldn't just be a matter of seeking its hidden cause in some faculty or capacity or endowment or an abyssal decision or origin that lies outside the historical domain of human actions. Instead, the connection between individuals and actions, personal and collective, in the context of which a humanist why question can be asked, must be sought within the domain of actions, as constituted over time by our shared commitments, practices, and their various transformations. There's no point of indifference, to use Friedrich Schelling's phrase, from which to deduce subjective or objective predicaments. And this is where the title of my talk came from. Hegel famously dismissed Schelling's point of indifference as the night in which all cows are black. Great, great put down. So to pose the humanist question why with regard to historical or political or cultural developments is not to set out to solve a mystery or a riddle. Rather, we're interested in the possibility that there's no hidden mystery here, and that any human action or practice presupposes nothing other than a historically determined normative domain of actions as its condition of possibility. And for this reason, whatever we do ought to be explicable or intelligible, at least in principle. So the explanatory power of the modern humanities, let's say, are anchored by distinct sorts of actions and events that can be grasped by appealing to our capacity to give reasons or sense-making narratives rather than inferential or causal explanations. We imagine ourselves To give some examples, we imagine ourselves capable of debating good reasons for interpreting a work of literature in a certain way, or a legal document in a certain way, or of explaining the rise of futurism, or arguing about the significance of feminism, or 20th century music. The modern humanities, in other words, assume that we, our history, our products, events, and actions, are not twigs on a mighty stream carried along by forces or impulses for which we're not responsible. God, nature, biology, wholly arbitrary social contingencies, or the opacity of unconscious motivations, but rather that we're agents in history capable of bringing about immense changes in our habits and environments, as well as of achieving new stances on ourselves, fuller understanding of our activities. And the humanities assume further that in giving reasons for what we're doing, we make very strong claims about our actions, that we do have our reasons, and not just external causes for having done certain things, and that even when these turn out to have been misguided or indefensible, our actions and practices are our own, potentially intelligible to us, rather than emanations from some higher external power or causa prima. Indeed, perhaps it's because our past and present practices or deepest values can come to seem misguided or practically unsustainable that we can aspire to some account of how we started to do the things that we do. Now, all of this implies that we are invariably interacting with one another in socially determined ways, in norm-governed relations and institutional practices. Indeed, one of the distinguishing features of humanist inquiry in this regard that makes the study of history and old texts, for example, so crucial to our self-understanding, is that we don't imagine that reason-giving, both its formal possibility as well as its specific content, can be separated from an awareness of social structures and customs at a particular time and place. We have no historical standpoint on ourselves, no standpoint out there, in or on nature, no divine or Archimedean point. So our reflections on social history and the understanding such reflections might afford are unavoidably enmeshed in the history of our customs and practices. And this entails further, seeing that all along our practices have been forms of self-reflection. To invoke Hegel, to understand our historical practices as ours, rather than as expressions of some natural or divine or unconscious power, means coming to see them as having also been modes of deliberation and reflection, ways of figuring out good reasons for doing this or that, reasons we might call our own. Now, in order for what I'm calling humanist inquiry to seem important and necessary, it also has to be shown that the history of our activities, values, and transformations really is self-starting, self-determining all the way down, and not brought into being by some pre-normative or non-normative cause. And that's a tall order, to say the least. It is, however, one that many have not shied away from, starting, one could say, with Hegel's account of the struggle for recognition, and continuing through the work of many others since then. In fact, many pressing issues in the broad post-Kantian inheritance of the modern humanities have been brought on by a perceptible shift away from what is sometimes called philosophy of nature questions, such as, what is it about nature or the natural world, or what is there in bodies, objects, and natural processes that makes possible cultural meaning, freedom, and self-determination? Moving away from those kinds of questions toward the sorts of questions that I'm calling humanistic questions, the why questions, why did we do this question? So among other things, humanistic inquiry has managed to displace the primacy of philosophy of nature questions by regarding them not so much as wrong-headed in some absolute sense, but just as one part, albeit an historically necessary part, of an ongoing effort to understand the constitutive role of human discourses and practices when it comes to determining even the outlines of natural processes or of the human body, as well as related categories like the environment, desire, sex, or life. One way of describing this shift, I'm talking about the shift of the last couple of centuries in humanist inquiry, would be to say that we've moved away from looking to nature or to the body or to desire or to the environment and related notions for explanations of what we do. And along the way, we've come to regard such explanatory appeals to nature, philosophy of nature questions, not as incorrect, but as the upshot of certain discursive practical conditions for which we can now offer at least a plausible historical account. So to state the matter in fairly familiar Foucauldian terms, there's broad agreement among humanists, I think, that philosophies of nature, as well as their supposed references, nature, the body, and desire, are formed in and by power relations, rather than being merely explanations for power relations. But Everything depends on how we understand that phrase, formed in and by power relations. Sometimes this is glossed as meaning that nature or the body are discursive constructs, where discourse can mean everything from something linguistically structured to more capacious notion of bodily productivity, closer to Karl Marx's historical materialism. Although this is often taken to mean that nature or the body are blank slates, void of meaning or pre-meaningful, on which cultural values are then inscribed, I think a better formulation has been offered by Judith Butler, interpreting Foucault, when she writes, "The point has never been that everything is discursively constructed, for constructivism just ends up posing the familiar philosophy of nature questions under the guise of what we might call a philosophy of discourse. In other words, instead of looking to nature, we now say, what is it about discourse or language? There's the symbolic that makes possible social meaning." The obvious problem with this approach, as Foucault, Butler, and a great many others make clear, is that discourse becomes the new a priori substance under investigation, thereby reinstalling the same split between discourse and embodiment, history, nature, culture, desire, and so forth. At the same time, as Butler notes, avoiding such dualisms also means understanding the body not just as an ontological there-ness that exceeds or counters the boundaries of discourse. Hence, the task taken up in various ways by the human sciences has been to think about the limits of nature or of the body as belonging to normative practices, which are in turn sustained by the delineation of such limits. So far, I'm just summarizing. I take it that we can all more or less follow as a summary what I'm giving here. Although there are many competing viewpoints to which I cannot hope to do justice in this brief time, one currently prevailing consensus about how to explain normative autonomy goes like this. If normative practical domains are sustained through the delineation of their own limits, then they're said to require what Butler and Ernesto Laclau and Chantal Mouffe and others have called a constitutive outside. So normative domains thus amount to an exclusionary matrix that produces a domain of abject beings, a constitutive outside to the domain of the subject. So a familiar position from deconstruction, the structuralism. Of course, such statements remain the topic of much debate and contestation. I simply wish to mark what I take to be a broad agreement, a kind of orthodoxy in the human sciences, that the sustenance of normative practices and values not only entails but requires the production of something or someone fails to live up to the norm. So within the constitutive outside theory, then, we've arrived at what I think is the current predominant answer to what I earlier called the tall order of humanistic inquiry, namely an account of how our history and the history of our activities and values can be seen as self-starting, normatively autonomous all the way down. What the constitutive theory provides, what the constitutive outside theory provides, in other words, is not just the assertion that human cultural practices are self-determining, but it offers an account of how human cultural practices are self-sustaining, self-determining, self-delineating, by arguing that the normative conditions of human life are established and sustained through the production of an abject outside. The production of unlivable lives, lives that can be suffered but not led, unleadable lives, forms something like the precondition for lives that can be normatively lived or led. So much for the summary. To now move to my own suggestions. I want to suggest there are some significant drawbacks to the constitutive outside theory as a defense of normative autonomy. First, it can be difficult, according to the constitutive outside theory, to see in social change anything other than brute contingency, or the accidental results of various power struggles, whose inevitability remains unexplained and uninvestigated. Very often in contemporary debates, it's as if every normative regime is merely the result of a contingent exercise of power, as if the autonomy of normative life resented an endless round of musical chairs, the game that you play to sit down on the chairs, producing legitimate players by virtue of the exclusion of others, but without any convincing account of why this particular contest of power is taking place. In other words, if the constitutive outside theory helps us to see how normative domains are self-sustaining, or how social structures reproduce themselves, then it does not necessarily help us to better understand which norms or values are reproduced, or why certain norms are contested or become sites of power struggle. In other words, we're at a kind of impasse for the humanistic question, why? For instance, if the production of lives both livable and unlivable invariably belongs to our commitments, habits, and practices, to the success or failure of reigning norms, then might we aspire to anything more than a kind of historical sociological description of what different communities have taken to be normatively authoritative at different moments and places?
È troppo veloce.
Okay. Sorry. Faccio un riassunto in italiano a questo punto.
L'eccesso di velocità deve essere pulito.
Non è pulito? Ah, deve essere punito. Punito. Fin qua il punto è questo. Sto dicendo che English please. Okay. So I want to suggest that the drawbacks to the constitutive outside theory are that it makes it difficult to explain particular changes in normative regimes. In other words, everything starts to look like a contingent power struggle rather than something that has a certain historical necessity to it. So if we cannot explain to ourselves something of the necessity of certain power struggles, if we can't establish why and how certain norms get established or become contestable, then the brute contingency of power struggles starts to look like nothing more than a new candidate for the position previously occupied by nature in philosophies of nature. And there's a kind of return of structuralism even. In other words, the interests of power, based on contingent social and class interests, starts to look like an explicans for everything, the installation of hegemonic formations. So I want to see if we can do more than that. Now, in saying this, in suggesting this, I don't mean to deny that an ideology or genealogy critique, such as one finds in the early work of Foucault or in Bourdieu, helpfully exposes how the primary institutions of late modernity, hospitals, prisons, bureaucracies, psychiatric wards, and so forth, derive much of their authority from social class interests inherent in bourgeois societies. We can agree, I think, that any discussion of a particular social problem, medical issues, education, crime, and so on, must ask who gets to define the problem and on what terms. But in asking such questions, are we not asking for something more than a sociological historical investigation that will turn out to be a story of vested interests or power maintenance or of hegemony? In other words, while we might learn a great deal from ideological critics about how claims to knowledge work to legitimate repressive institutions and practices, do we not want to know something about the alternative? Alternative, I mean, not just to the powers that be, but rather alternatives to a vision of society in which the possibility of leading one's life appears to be the contingent result of varying power formations whose historical necessity remains unclear. So one step in the direction of an alternative might be taken, I'm going to suggest, by interrogating Foucault's view that power formations operate according to broad historical conditions, on a variety of cultural norms concerning everything from sex, gender, kinship, marriage, crime, medicine, madness, and so forth. As readers of Foucault will have noticed, Foucault himself seems to have been uncertain which, if any, of these normative domains, medicine, psychiatry, prisons, best displays how power operates. Indeed, we might wonder if there really is such a thing as power under which all kinds of social and cultural norms can be subsumed. Or at least, we might suspect that each of these norms requires or instantiates its own dimension of power. But then, what, if anything, would count as a significant dimension of power? That is, which customs and activities might be understood not only to require and institute their own distinctive domains, probably all activities do that, but also to do so in ways that foreground what is at stake in such requiring and instituting more generally? Do certain historical practices make possible, perhaps due to some requirement or characteristic of those practices, some understanding of what is required more generally for a particular activity to be sustained over time? Or do all customs and activities, from relatively new and modern ones like modern art or the enforcement of individual rights, to older ones like sharing a meal or regulating sexual acts socially, do all normative actions display their distinctive regulatory regime so idiosyncratically that it becomes impossible to ask how any of these practices investigated might shed light on any number of others. Here, much will depend, I think, on whether we think it's fruitful to talk about something like culture or power or discourse or social self-reproduction in a modestly general or universal, some might say philosophical, sense. Is it possible to go even a step beyond fine-grained philological, ethnographic, archival, or sociological description in our analyses? This raises a related question of how discursive fields of inquiry accrue their claim to specificity anyway. So again, the question of the status of culture or power or discourse gets begged. A great many broad debates in the last half of the 20th century have turned on these same questions. For instance, the shift from structuralist to post-structuralist modes of inquiry might be described as a shift away from attempts to discern universal laws of culture out of particular social practices, toward an increased skepticism about whether there's anything universally true about culture or discourse or language, discernible apart from its practical installation. So the post-structuralist position, I take it, is that the force of a given norm is wholly dependent on its historical durée and active repetition. Lacking practical iteration, norms fail. Fair enough, we can agree on this. But then again, this begs the question I was trying to raise earlier. Can we explain or give reasons for, answer the why question, for the duration or failure of certain normative regimes, especially for the failure of quite long-lasting ones? For example, can we explain the collapse of the sexual division of labor? Or can we explain the relative duration of norms like gender? In other words, even if we could concur with the so-called post-structuralist position and say that normative force is enabled through its practical repetition, we might still want to know, after all, why certain normative practices fail or endure. We might want to know if, when, and how certain norms fail is significant. Significant, I mean, for our historical self-understanding, as well as for ethical political questions, like which norms do we require to make life bearable for ourselves and others? Indeed, in order to answer these questions, we might want something more than what I was calling a musical chairs vision of such success and failure, something more than the conclusion that power is historically contingent. And so we might ask, what is at stake in the success or failure of certain normative regimes, such that the history of normative success and failure might amount to something more than one damn thing after another? After all, without some kind of answer to that question, we're left wondering why anyone should try to understand social change or the history of a normative domain in the first place. Either that, or as it sometimes starts to look in contemporary political discourse, that we can do nothing more than ask in a kind of survivalist mode, what makes our lives bearable, or what makes the lives of others bearable? Such pressing questions of individual rights or social justice are surely essential to humanist inquiry, but to conclude that humanist inquiry is just a matter of addressing these problems seems rather short-sighted. At a minimum, it begs the question I was trying to raise of why struggling to lead one's life freely or even bearably ever came to seem important in the first place. To what view of a bearable life are we committed, and why? And we might bear in mind these latter questions are not simply answered by pursuing here and now social justice and rights, even as any answer to that first set of questions will entail a commitment to having answered the latter. In short, it seems important to give some account of how we got here. We should be able to explain why the normative authority of a gender-based division of labor is collapsing, why access to birth control or abortion has become a pressing rights issue over the past few generations, or why gender studies is now essential to humanist inquiry. This is not to say there need to be one single explanation for these questions, but, and this is my suggestion, we should probably narrow down the alternatives considerably to the point where only a few possible answers could even make much sense historically. The aim, in other words, for the humanities need not be the demonstration of absolute historical necessity. We can assume matters could have come to stand otherwise. But, to state my conclusion, with a good enough understanding of why certain previous normative regimes fail, we ought to be able to show that, given the contexts created by the reasons given for certain activities, past and present, certain power struggles become possible, perhaps even inevitable, while other power struggles start to look historically senseless, not worth the effort. So the ambition of the humanities with respect to political discourse ought to be to give an answer to the why question for these struggles.
C'è tempo per fare un piccolo.
Ok, faccio il riassunto. Ok, ci sono quattro punti più o meno. I quattro punti sono che gli studi umanistici, perché volevo parlare dal punto di vista degli studi umanistici, intervenire in questo modo. Gli studi umanistici, a mio avviso, cominciano nella modernità con Rousseau, che cerca di cavare un dominio di storia e azioni umane alla quale possiamo dare una spiegazione ragionevole, storica, che non ricade né nella rivelazione teologica né nelle scienze moderne. Quindi gli studi umanistici, si può dire, rispondono alla domanda perché? Perché è successo questo? Perché lei ha agito in questo modo? Quindi se la scommessa degli studi umanistici è che possiamo dare una risposta ragionevole a questa domanda perché. Questa è la prima cosa. La seconda parte del talk era che una grande tendenza nel secolo scorso è stato quello di mostrare che l'autonomia di questo dominio normativo che cavava Rousseau può essere difeso con la teoria di quello che si chiama il fuori costitutivo, si dice in italiano?
Sì, sì.
Okay. Il fuori costitutivo fa vedere il modo in cui le domande che appartenevano una volta alla filosofia della natura, perché la filosofia natura avrebbe posto questa domanda: che cos'è nella natura che rende possibile il significato culturale e così via. La teoria del fuori costitutivo, parlando in termini molto generici, dice che è inutile porsi delle domande sulla natura ed è altrettanto inutile porsi delle domande, per lo stesso motivo, sul discorso sulla cultura. E piuttosto cerca di abolire questo dualismo, facendo vedere il modo in cui categorie come corpo, natura, desiderio e così via sono delineate dalle pratiche culturali, che appartengono alle pratiche culturali. Ora, volevo solo fare questo riassunto per dire che questa teoria del fuori costitutivo è finora, diciamo, la teoria più predominante, per farla breve, che difende l'autonomia del dominio normativo sulla quale resta gli studi umanistici. Però ci lascia una certa impasse. L'impasse è questa: non ci permette di rispondere alla domanda perché questo regime normativo cambia. Per farla breve, la teoria del fuori costitutivo, a mio avviso, ci lascia pensare che tutti i cambiamenti, tutte le trasformazioni sociali storiche sono dovute a motivi contingenti, lotti di potere contingenti, che non hanno una necessità storica, che non sono spiegabili. E quindi, da un certo punto di vista, minacciano gli studi umanistici, installando la teoria del fuori costitutivo come nuova natura. Il posto che la natura occupava nella filosofia della natura. Questa è la critica. Come rispondere a questo impasso? Lì cercavo di far vedere un'osservazione molto banale, ma secondo me anche forse feconda, su Foucault. Che Foucault cercava di identificare quelle pratiche, quelle regime normative che potevano fornire insight, come si dice?
Insight.
Una visione su come funzionano i domini normativi genericamente. E Foucault andava a pescare nelle prigioni, nella medicina e così. Però secondo me il suo scopo era quello di capire come i cambiamenti normativi succedono genericamente, quindi rispondere al perché. Quindi alla fine del mio talk davo come ambizione per gli studi umanistici questo compito di identificare quali sono i domini normativi che potrebbero fornire le tracce della ragione, le tracce della ragione capaci di fornire una risposta alla domanda storica perché. Questi sono i quattro punti.
Bene, grazie. Thank you.